Hello guys, welcome back. In this video, we will be discussing about few important questions related to computer vision. So these questions are very generic and widely asked. They are not related to any specific domain or specific industry, but you know, they are the most popular questions and very basic questions as well, which we must be aware about before attending any interviews. So let's start. First question, what is a pixel? A pixel means a picture element. It is the smallest element of an image on a computer display. For a binary image, a pixel can take value 0 or 255. But in color image, it can be anywhere between 0 to 255. Now, the multiple pixels arranged in rows and columns forms an image, and there are typically four categories into which any image is divided. That is binary, black and white, grayscale and color. Now, as you can see from the shown image, that first image is a color image because the pixel value is anywhere between 0 to 255. The last image is a black and white because it has value 0 or 255 for any image. The third image, that is the second, the middle image, that is, it's a grayscale. So it is made up of pixels value of 0 to 255 of different intensities. That's the reason it is a grayscale. So If you go back 50 years, from now, when we didn't have capability of capturing colors from any image, it used to call it as black and white. However, now if you take this example, they were actually the grayscale images and not a black and white, because they had different shades of black and white in it that forms as a grayscale image. Second question is, what is transfer learning? So I have already covered this in my earlier video, but just to have a small recap. So what's a transfer learning? So let's take an example. There's a model which is used by the manufacturing industry. That model can detect vehicles of different shapes and different sizes, and it can also detect color of the vehicles. Now you have a new requirement where you want to detect mobile phones and tablets of different sizes. So can you use that same model that is used by the manufacturing industry for your purpose? Yes, you can. That is called transfer learning. So what you have to do in your new model, you can incorporate the exact same old model and just add one more layer at the last. After adding one more layer, you just have to train with your new images, and your new project, your new model can be trained in no time. It will take lesser than the model which you have to train from the scratch, and the accuracy will also be very, very high. So that is called transfer learning. Now there's a sub question with this, that is, how would you select the best model for your project? So in this particular case, if you have a requirement to detect objects, so which project would you use for transfer learning? So you can use transfer learning. There are many models available, but which one would you prefer? Which one should you select? You should select based on your requirement. So if you have a requirement for object detection, you should use any model such as YOLO and SSD. YOLO, that is, you only look once, and SSD is single shot detection. So based on your requirement, you can choose a similar model from the market. It may not be exactly same or matching your 100% requirement. However, it should be 50 to 60% similar to your new requirement. That's how you select your model for transfer learning. Third question is matrix to detect vertical and horizontal edges. So we know that OpenCV has many APIs and methods which we can use to detect edges, that is vertical and horizontal edges. Example of those some of the methods are Kenny edge detection, Gaussian filters, and some others. So what's the logic behind those methods? Let's discuss by taking one example. So as you can see on my screen, the first matrix on the upper left corner, that is for the to detect vertical edges, and the second image on the top right corner, that is for the horizontal image. So as you know, that any image will have pixel values. So an image is made up of different pixels, and each pixel can have values between 0 to 255 for color image. So it's like a matrix of values between 0 to 255. So if we multiply that matrix with our vertical edge detection matrix, it will have some kind of an output. That output can detect or can have only vertical edges, and all the values will be zeroed, or it will be, you know, it will have values zero, that is black. Now same goes for the horizontal image. If you multiply the, you know, matrix of pixels to our horizontal detection matrix, it will have zero values everywhere apart from, you know, the horizontal lines which our image had. Now as you can see in the example, the first image on the right, you know, top corner, that is for vertical edge, that those are the vertical edges from the input image, and the second image is the horizontal, you know, edges from the input image. That's, and the logic behind those, you know, detection technique is the matrix multiplication. That's it. So there are, different matrices, you know, available in the market. That the first one which I showed, that was a very basic one. There are a few other matrices as well. That is, you can have twos in instead of one in the matrices. As you can see here, you can have twos instead of one, so that, you know, your output image will have more sharper edges. That's a technique, but however, it doesn't work every time. So that's it for this question. Thank you. Fourth question is difference between YOLO V3 and SSD. Explain anyone. So YOLO is you only look once. SSD is single shot detection. Both are widely used deep learning models for real-time object detection. They both are used for monitoring purpose, can be used for monitoring purpose, and used in CCTV cameras for security surveillance, for traffic monitoring as well. So what's the key difference between YOLO and SSD? Now on my screen, you can see the architecture of SSD on the top and a part, and then the bottom layer, we have architecture of YOLO. So in the first top layer, as you can see, SSD has only single fully connected layer, only single neural network, and it uses filter sizes of 1x1, 3x3, 5x5. So what does that mean? That means it can detect very small objects as well, because it has filter size of 1x1. It makes a bit, you know, more number of calculations will be required, of course. However, you know, if you use filter of size 1x1, you know, you can detect more number of, you know, features from any input image. And the second layer, you can see it's a YOLO. YOLO uses two fully connected layer. In the first fully connected layer, it will decide, you know, what kind of grid sizes, you know, that a particular image should have. It will, you know, decide the anchor boxes as well, and all those details will be, you know, will then be fed to the second fully connected layer, and then, you know, all kinds of convolution will be, you know, will be performed in the YOLO network, and the output will have all the, you know, objects detected with the particular bounding boxes as well. So if you see in the you know, the right part of the screen, it shows the FPS, that is frame per second. So SSD can process images with a speed of 59 frames per second, and YOLO can process the similar image with 45 frames per second. So YOLO is faster, my bad, SSD is faster because it has only single convolutional layer, and it uses 1x1 filters so that it can detect more number of, you know, images, as well as smaller tiny part of the images also, you know, objects also it can detect. And, you know, YOLO also, it's not bad, you know, the accuracy is very similar. They both are used for different purposes, like for different models as well. So that's the key difference between YOLO and SSD. And the second sub part is explain anyone. So I've already covered YOLO V3 in my earlier video. You can go through it. It has one live example as well, and ready to, you know, use code as well. That code has object detection in images, live video stream, and any, you know, input video as well. So you can use it. Okay, let's discuss about the last question and the most important question of this video. What is 1x1 convolution? So the 1x1 convolution is a feature pooling technique. It is widely used for dimensionality reduction as well. Now remember this line. The output of your convolution layer is width multiplied by depth multiplied by height. That is from the input image. Now if the depth is greater than the input depth, you will have higher dimensional output. If depth is lower than the input depth, you will achieve dimensionality reduction. This is the main logic behind 1x1 convolution. Let's take an example of an image. Now, this is an example of a max pooling. So what is max pooling? So if you use a 2x2 matrix and if you try to do a max pooling, what it does, it will try to convolve a 2x2 matrix and it will search for the maximum value between the four, that is, you know, it's a 2x2 matrix. So what's the maximum between the first and our matrix, that is the 20. In the second, it's 30. In the down one, the purple one, it's 112. And in the other green one, that is 37. So the output is 20, 30, 112, 37. That is called the max pooling. Now there's one more concept called average pooling. That is, it will add all the values from the image, all the values of that pixel, it will divide by 4. That is called average pooling. But what is feature pooling in this, you know, in this one by one? So in this particular image, you can see there's a rabbit or what, squirrel, my bad. So it's a squirrel, and you can see in the red boxes, these are the image, these are the, you know, features, the important features that has been detected by our neural network. Now, do you think that, you know, our neural network can detect only 5? No. So our neural network can detect, you know, hundreds of different features from that image, and all those features are just, you know, are the numbers. So if you have more number of features from the images, your neural network will be slow. So what we want only the top, you know, feature maps, the features from that image, and we just want to reduce the number of features, because, you know, it will make our calculation take longer and longer, and our result will be very, very slow. So that is called feature pooling. Now let's take an example. Now if you have the, you know, 192 features detected of size 28 by 22, as shown in the first screen, these are the feature maps, and each feature map is of size 28 by 28, and this 192 is not the, you know, RGB, it's a channel. That is, these are the number of features that our neural network has been detected. Now we don't want 192, because that's too much for the calculation. Your neural network will take, you know, hours and hours to train. Now what we can do, we can use a one by one filter of channel 192, because we have to match the number of channels in the filter as well. And in the output, you can see the output has only 28 by 28 by 32 channels. Now here the 32 is the number of feature maps that has been reduced from 192 to 32. Now does that mean that we are losing something? No. That means we are only selecting the most important and the most valuable features from all the 192 features that our neural network has detected. That is how it is, you know, doing a dimensionality reduction. So that's it for this video, guys. Thank you so much for watching. Bye bye.